thanks so much for the invitation. It's great to be here and have the privilege of talking to you tonight. I think maybe my first slide has already been covered by this wonderful introduction, so I'll go relatively briefly. Here's the decision predicament we're interested in. It's paradigmatically the decision predicament of an effective altruist. I call it that of the open-minded philanthropist. Call her Shivani. Shivani controls a pot of $1 million. Her aim is to spend this money in whatever way would most improve the world, and she's open in principle to considering any project as a means to doing this. The open-mindedness is important, and that's very characteristic of effective altruism. Unlike some philanthropists, Shivani has not gone into the business of philanthropy because she has a passion for some particular cause area, be it football or opera or the arts. Rather, she's just gone into the business of philanthropy because she wants to help the world, and in principle, this could involve focusing on any cause area. She's just looking for where it turns out to be the case, as a matter of empirical facts, that there are the opportunities to do the most good per dollar donated. So she's aware that she has a fixed budget, $1 million, that's all she's got. She wants that money to go as far as it possibly can in terms of making the world better in this completely neutral, impartial sense. What then should she do with it? Well, presumably not spend it on herself. That would generate some value, it would make Shivani happier. But the first thought that will probably occur to you if Shivani contemplates doing that is, well, $1 is worth a lot less to somebody who's already rich than it is to somebody who's very poor. So if we want to know, for example, by what mode of spending the money could Shivani generate the most happiness, she's already rich, it's not going to be spending it on herself. She should perhaps consider spending it on something that helps the world's poorest people. Maybe she should give it to Oxfam. Well, Oxfam is very salient, but if you're really serious about this project of doing the most good per dollar donated, organisations like Oxfam are unlikely to be optimal for the simple reason that those organisations do lots of different things. If you're really trying to optimise, then an organisation that's doing lots of different things is almost inevitably going to be doing some things perhaps that are very cost effective, that do a lot of good done per dollar spent, but since it's doing lots of different things, it's also likely to be doing some things that are less cost effective. And you would prefer, if you have Shivani's aims, you would prefer to just be funding an organisation that only does the thing that's most cost effective and not one that has this very broad portfolio. So which particular things then might be the very most cost effective things? There's been some consensus in the effective altruism community for a while that many of the most cost effective opportunities lie in the field of global health, and in particular perhaps distributing long-lasting insecticide treated bed nets to protect children in developing countries from malaria. Another very popular option is deworming. You can cure a child of parasitic worms that prevent them from going to school for as little as something like 30 pence, 30 cents maybe, per child dewormed in some countries. So those are very cost-effective opportunities. And then, as we saw in the introductory spiel, other popular things are focusing on farm animal welfare, perhaps by promoting vegetarianism and veganism, or focusing on the very long-run future, for example, taking action to mitigate risks of premature human extinction. I'm going to say a lot more in this talk about options in the vicinity of that last one. The relevant feature of those is that the way that they create value in the world is not so much by doing something that's extremely beneficial for welfare now, rather they focus on trying to do something that's beneficial to some extent across the course of a very long-run future. And because the future is potentially so large, things that do that can potentially generate a lot of value when you add it up across all the time. So that last thing is the theme I want to focus on tonight. Here's a rough outline of what I plan to say. The first section consists of preliminaries. I'll try to articulate more precisely a thesis that you might call long-termism, so we have something to put up there and think about whether it's true or false. In order to even talk about this project, though, in order to say anything about how Shivani should be thinking about cost effectiveness for any of the things on that list I had a minute ago, we're going to need to say a fair bit about how one acts rationally in the face of uncertainty, because for any of those interventions, even things like bed nets, there's always going to be significant uncertainty about what the effects actually would be of Shivani funding this thing. That becomes particularly salient in the long-termist context, but it's always there, even in the case of bed nets. So I'll say a little bit at the beginning about how philosophers and economists standardly think about rational decision-making under uncertainty. And then I'll close that first section with some remarks about the relationship between this general shift in the effective altruist community towards a long-termist way of thinking on the one hand, And the thing that was initially very characteristic of the effective altruism community, which was a strong focus on rigorous evidence, on the other hand, I think those two things are in a fairly obvious tension with one another that might be interesting to highlight. So that's the first section. So then, having set out a long-termist thesis, in the second section I want to say why I think, at least until and unless we see some compelling objection, we should be reasonably sympathetic to the long-termist thesis. We should think it's reasonably likely that some thesis like this is true. Roughly that the most cost-effective opportunities to do good probably lie in the domain of trying to influence the course of the very long-run future. And then in the last section, I want to take on what I think is the most compelling objection to long-termism. It's not a philosophical matter, actually. It's a simple empirical matter. It's the worry that, given the causal structure of the world, the way we find it, it's just too intractable to try to do something that influences the whole course of the very long run. If that was the case, to a sufficiently large extent, it could render long-termism false. I tentatively think that's not the way things go. I tentatively think long-termism is true, despite this worry about it getting increasingly difficult to have influence the further out you go in time. So I'll give you some examples of the kind of things I think we might consider doing to illustrate why I think. Please do ask questions as we go along, especially if there are things you don't understand, but also if you want to raise objections and have discussion as we go. Any questions so far? Or are we all good? Okay. So normally, in situations like this, the dynamics is such that lots of people want to ask a question, but nobody wants to be first. So if you feel brave enough to go first, you'll be doing a public service. Okay, so the first section then, uncertainty, long-termism, and evidence, like miscellaneous remarks on those three topics. I'll take uncertainty first. So as I mentioned a minute ago, all of the things Shivani could do involve significant uncertainty, even in the case of distributing, like to say deciding between bed nets and deworming. In neither of those cases does she know exactly what the consequences of her actions would be if she decided to fund the bed nets or if she decided to fund the deworming. And because of that, she doesn't know for sure which of the actions would turn out to be best if she could then wait 1,000 years and see which one turned out to have the best consequences. Even if she could wait 1,000 years, of course, she still wouldn't find out because she would only see the consequences of the thing she actually did and not the other thing that she might have done. However, this impossibility of knowledge of what would turn out to be the very best thing, of course, doesn't mean that rational action is impossible. There are still more or less sensible ways she could go about making her decision in the face of uncertainty. And this is familiar even from the non-philanthropic context. All of us in our everyday decisions, every day, every minute, face uncertainty, and we have to make sensible decisions in the face of it. The standard way that philosophers and economists tend to think about rational action under the face of uncertainty, so to be clear, this is not supposed to be a descriptive theory of how people actually make decisions, it's supposed to be a normative theory of how people should make decisions, that is to say, how rational people will make decisions in the face of uncertainty. According to that theory, the rational agent assigns probabilities to all the various possible things that might happen as a result of any given action. She also assigns values, measuring how good or bad she thinks those various possible outcomes would be. Then define the expected value of a given option to be the probability-weighted average of all the possible values that might result. And then expected value theory says the rational agent chooses, of all the available actions, she chooses the one that has the highest expected value. Okay, so that was pretty abstract. Let me give you an example to illustrate how expected value reasoning might work in practice. So this is a just very mundane, prudential example. It's not about philanthropic decision making. You can be thinking in entirely selfish terms here. You're going out for a walk. That's the thing you're definitely going to do. You have uncertainty, in this case, about whether or not it's going to rain. And the decision you have to take in this simple example is whether or not to take an umbrella. But you're uncertain about whether it rains, so what should you do? Well, intuitively, this depends on a bunch of quantitative things. The more likely you think it is that it's going to rain, the more you should be inclined towards taking an umbrella. And it's also going to depend on how much you dislike getting wet and how annoying you find it to carry an umbrella when you're going around for a walk in the nice sunshine. So expected value theory takes account of all this stuff. It provides us with a nice little model to show, firstly, the fact that all these numbers are relevant, and then, secondly, a recipe for showing you what relevance they have, how you get from these numbers to a recommendation for a decision. So here's one way it might pan out. Suppose, for the sake of argument, you think the probability of rain is 50%, you think it's just as likely to rain as not. And suppose your tastes are such that your preferences among the various possible outcomes are represented by these numbers I've put up on the slide. So the very worst thing, according to you, is getting wet. Slightly better than that is going for a walk in the rain, but protected by an umbrella. Somewhat better than that, again, is going for a walk in the sunshine, but having to drag this umbrella around. However, you find dragging the umbrella around really quite annoying. So the biggest leap in terms of your taste is the one that goes from dragging an umbrella around in the sunshine to getting to go for a walk unencumbered in the sunshine. Somebody might have tastes like that. Maybe they're yours, maybe they're not. Let's consider an agent that is well described by these numbers. What would it be rational for this agent to do? Well, I said expected value theory advises the agent to implicitly or explicitly calculate the expected value of every given option. How would that work in this case? Well, the two options were take the umbrella versus not. So if you want to know what's the expected value of taking the umbrella, then you take the probability weighted average of the values she might get from taking the umbrella. That is to say, the value that she gets if she takes the umbrella and it rains, that is 10. And the value that she gets if she takes the umbrella and it doesn't rain, that is 20. So the expected value of taking the umbrella is 15. On the other hand, the expected value of not taking the umbrella is 20 in this example. So according to expected value theory, the rational thing for her to do under uncertainty is to not take the umbrella. Now, of course, that might turn out to be the wrong thing to do. If it rains, it will turn out to have been the wrong thing to do in one sense. Nonetheless, it will have been the rational thing to do under uncertainty. So I kind of labour this point a little because it's important when we're considering Shivani's decision context that we don't get hung up on the fact that what she does might turn out after the dust has settled to be suboptimal. What we want to know is, what is it rational for her to do in the face of her uncertainty, given the information that she has at the time of the decision? Okay, so that said, let's now go on to long-termism. To get into the long-termist frame of mind, consider the following two thoughts. One is not a scientific matter, if you like, it's an evaluative matter, so an opinion about which things are morally important. The evaluative thought is the thought that insofar as the consequences of your actions matter, like clearly they do, in whatever sense the consequences of your actions matter for the purpose of decision making, all of the consequences of your actions should matter and should matter equally. The reason I emphasise this is that there are some aspects of it that are controversial in the long-termist context. The thing that it implies that are controversial are that it doesn't make a difference to how much the effect matters, how far in the future, compared to the time of action, the effect in question is. If there was something you knew would result from your action in 1,000 years' time, that would matter for decision-making purposes just as much as if the thing that you knew would happen would instead happen tomorrow, according to this first thought. And then the second thought that gets you into the long-termist frame of mind is a descriptive and empirical thought rather than an evaluative one. It's the thought that if humanity doesn't go prematurely extinct, on which more in a bit, potentially the number of human beings and other sentient creatures that could exist in the future is truly astronomical. I'll give you some numbers in a few slides' time, but it's a really, really big number. And then the point of emphasising this is that when you put these two things together, the thought that all the consequences matter and the thought that the number of beings out there in the long run future to potentially be affected by our actions is enormous, it becomes at least somewhat plausible that even after we take into account the matter of uncertainty, that is, even after we take into account the fact that as you go further and further out into the future, generally it becomes more and more uncertain what the effect of our actions will be, even given that, in expected value terms, it might turn out that the very best actions are best primarily because of their anticipated effects on the course of the very long run future and not because of their more immediate effects, where more immediate means something like in the next 10 years, in the next 50 years, in the next 100 years even. Suppose long-termism is true for the sake of argument now, so I'm going to talk in a bit about whether we should think it's true or not. First, let's just think for a moment about what its implications are if it's true. Well, it doesn't immediately tell Shivani what to do. In particular, it doesn't even immediately tell Shivani that she should be thinking about something like extinction risk mitigation rather than, say, bed nets. The reason it doesn't is you might think, while when we're talking about funding bed nets, we're normally mostly thinking about the short-run effects of doing so. So we're thinking about the lives that will be saved, the lives of the children who actually put that net over them. That's the thing we're mostly focusing on. But in principle, there are plausible mechanisms by which that short-term benefit could then cause a cascade of longer-term benefits. There could, in principle, be effects of saving the life cascading down the millennia. So it could be that, for long-termist reasons, even bed nets is the best thing to fund, but if so, according to long-termism, it's not going to be because of the short-term effects that we're normally focusing on. It's going to be because of the long-run implications. Okay, so that's why long-termism doesn't immediately answer Shivani's question. You might think that something more like extinction risk mitigation is the long-termist thing to focus on, but it may not be because other things have long-term implications too. What it does do is give her a fairly reliable heuristic for going about answering her question, because if long-termism is true, what that suggests is that for the purpose of finding the best option, Shivani might as well just ignore the effects of the various things she can do over the course of the next century. If she can identify which of her actions has the best effect from 100 years' time out to infinity, then probably, if long-termism is true, that's also going to be the thing that has the best effect overall when you count all of the actions. If the long-term effects dominate the expected value calculation, you could just pay attention to those and forget the shorter-term stuff. Okay. If that's true, then it has some pretty revisionary implications. So this is the bit about effective altruism and evidence in the light of long-termism. Historically speaking, as the effective altruist movement developed, I think a major insight of the early effective altruist movement, a major distinctive thing about it compared to conventional models of philanthropy, was its observation that just as we do in the domain of private spending, so spending on ourselves, so similarly when we're doing philanthropic spending, we should be really focusing on the question of how much bang do we get for our buck. If you go to buy a dress, for instance, you look at how good the dress is and you look at how much it costs. You don't just decide that you want to go and spend £200 on a dress and not pay attention to what you get for your money. It's kind of strange then that in the still culturally dominant mode of thinking about philanthropy, it's enough to consider how much you're giving away to charity, and you don't need to do careful research into how effective that charity is. Effective altruism quite correctly emphasised that that's crazy, and that if we're serious about the point of giving to charity being to improve the world, we need to choose our charities very carefully and pay attention to how cost-effective they are. So that, I think, is still absolutely impeccable. The second thing that was distinctive of the early EA movement, though, was a strong emphasis on paying attention to evidence of effectiveness, where evidence meant something fairly rigorous, paradigmatically randomised controlled trials. So there was this movement in medicine, stretching back now several decades, where instead of placing most of the emphasis on the clinical intuition of the experienced physician, there was much more emphasis on so-called evidence-based medicine, where you conduct rigorous scientific experiments into which drugs work and to what extent they work, and on the basis of that information, you make your decisions about which pills to prescribe. Then, starting from around the 1990s, there was a kind of copycat movement in development economics, where organisations like JCAL in the US noticed that you could also do randomised controlled trials to investigate the question of which interventions actually work for alleviating poverty. And this was a major insight because the results are often extremely counterintuitive. If you want to know, for example, what kind of thing you should do insofar as your aim is to keep children in school for the most number of child school years per dollar donated, it's a priori completely not obvious whether the most effective thing to do will be to, say, fund school uniforms or provide sanitary product for teenage girls so they don't stay at home because they're too embarrassed about their period, or whether you should instead go around talking to parents about the benefits of keeping their children in school or what. Randomised controlled trials came along and tested all this stuff and gave us some answers to those questions based on real empirical evidence. And that was an extremely valuable contribution. However, if you're doing long-termist interventions, that is to say, if you think the main determinant of how cost-effective your intervention is at promoting the good over the course of the remaining history of the universe, if you think the main determinant of that is the very long-run future stuff, then you've got an obvious problem insofar as you also want to rely on the results of rigorous experiments, because it's not hard to see how it's going to be quite impossible to do randomised controlled trials to test which interventions work best at promoting the good over the course of the very long-run future. We don't have a billion years to wait for the results of that experiment to come in. We need to decide now. And so if you're going to be long-termist about your approach to effective altruism, you're going to have to somewhat weaken what was previously this quite heavy emphasis on very rigorous evidence, and you're going to have to indulge in a lot more informed speculation. That in some sense is unfortunate, but I think it's just a thing that we have to embrace. If it seems plausible that most of the benefits of our actions are in the very long run future, then we can't just bury our head in the sand and pretend to deny that because we're wedded to, we sort of got used to the comfort of having rigorous experiments to rely on. Okay, so now I've said this thing. Okay, so just a bit more on the last thing. Some people react to this unavailability of hard evidence by thinking that, well, if you don't have experiments telling you precisely what are the right probabilities to assign, then all bets are off. You know, you can make up your numbers, I can make up my numbers, any set of numbers is as good as any other, and so no intervention choices can be deemed irrational. I think this is throwing the baby out with the bathwater. Just because there aren't repeatable experiments telling us precisely what the answers should be, that doesn't mean that all bets are off. It doesn't mean that all numbers are equally reasonable or equally unreasonable. Topical example, if I ask you what's the probability that Britain will leave the European Union before December 2019, well, there isn't a randomised controlled trial to tell you the answer. But that doesn't mean that the right approach to questions like that, especially if some important decision hangs on it, like you're the owner of a business, and you really think and your best policy would be very different conditional on that Britain's going to leave the EU soon than it would be conditional on that Britain's going to stay in the EU for a longer time. You're not just going to say, well, you know, pick a number out of a hat, I don't care, there's nothing to guide me, any number is as good as any other. You're rather going to sit down and try to grapple with the complex empirical questions that feed into this question, talk to other people who have informed opinions, try to converge on some sensible number. That's the kind of thing we do there, where the decision is a non-philanthropic one. In the case of long-termist effect of altruism, we just need to do the same kind of things for the philanthropic context. So for instance here, I think an answer that's lower than 1% or higher than 99% would be just unreasonable, notwithstanding the fact that there's no randomized controlled trial to tell you so. Okay, so second section then, why do I think that until and unless an objection comes along, we should be broadly sympathetic towards long-termism? We should regard it as being broadly plausible ex ante. Let me try to convince you of that. So I'll say a few things in a few different sections. Firstly, I'll say a little bit more about just how big the future might be if we don't go extinct prematurely. Then, with some optional maths, if you're the kind of person who likes this, I'll sketch a little toy model, which for me at least, nicely and intuitively captures the key thought behind why long-termism might be plausible. Then I'll give a potential objection to the thought that long-termism is plausible, and the reply to that objection. The reply to that objection will then itself not just undermine the objection, but actually reinforce the case for long-termism. So then I'll summarise that lot at the end by summing up what the resulting plausibility argument looks like. Okay, so first some numbers. I said previously that if we don't go extinct prematurely, then the amount of sentient life in the future is potentially astronomical. Let's get a bit more precise. What exactly did I mean by astronomical? Well, here are some numbers that you might be useful for anchoring purposes. Suppose we're not talking about other species. Suppose we're just asking about the future of literally the human race. How long should we expect that to go on for? Well, one relevant data is that the average mammalian species, on average, they tend to last for between 1 and 2 million years. Consider then that so far the species Homo sapiens has only been around for about 200,000 years. So if you think we're a typical mammalian species, you should at least be thinking something like 1 million years is potentially what humanity has left. So now if you consider this question of whether I should expect the larger proportion of the effects of my actions to be in the next 100 years or in the further future beyond that. You're basically considering what I can do for the course of the next 100 years with what I can do over the course of the next 1 million years following on from there. And the point is 1 million years is a lot longer than 100 years. So if I can do anything at all to influence that 1 million years by even a tiny bit, that's got some pretty good prospects of competing with the amount by which I can influence the next 100 years in aggregate. Even that figure of 100 years, though, is pretty conservative, depending on how optimistic you are about various prospects for humanity doing much better than the average mammalian species and lasting a long time. So in order of increasing optimism, maybe you think the kind of thing that will wipe us out is not the kind of thing that wiped out an average mammal, but rather some mass extinction event, the kind of thing that wiped out the dinosaurs, perhaps. Well, the average historical frequency of those is only 1 in 100 million years. So if you think that's the kind of thing that wipes us out, then you should be thinking that we have an expected future more like 100 million years in length rather than 1 million years. Still more optimistically than that, maybe the hard constraint for us is just that eventually the Earth will become uninhabitable. But if you think that's what's going to kill us off, then you're talking about more like 1 billion years. And you could be more optimistic than that, even. There are projects afoot to conquer the problem of interstellar space travel. People have grand schemes to settle other star systems. If you think anything like that has even a small probability of working, then it provides some prospect by which, even after the Earth becomes uninhabitable, humans might continue to survive elsewhere in the universe. Now, given the fact that we're acting in the face of uncertainty, what we really want to know is something like, well, what's my probability distribution over these various possibilities? How long do I think, on average, given the uncertainties, humans are going to survive for? And when you're focusing on that question, if you have even a small credence in these more optimistic scenarios, that will tend to dramatically drag up the average. So in the light of all that stuff, I think saying that we should focus on the benchmark figure of 1 million years as being potentially the future survival lifespan for humanity is actually extremely conservative. But even that extremely conservative number is extraordinarily large compared to what we're thinking of as being the short term for present context, i.e. the next 100 years or so. Okay, so here the mathsy bit. If you don't like the mathsy bit, you can gloss over it. Here is a little model that, for me at least, neatly captures this thought that it's quite plausible that the most good we can do is via the good we can do on the very far future. Suppose we divide the future history of the universe into two time periods. There's the next 100 years, and then there's the rest. So from 100 years out to whenever the universe ends. Suppose we're comparing two things Siobhan might do. Thing one might be funding bed nets, or alternatively, doing something to mitigate extinction risk. And thing two is the do-nothing option, where she just hangs on to the money and never spends it. We want to know which of those two things is better in expected value terms, because we want to know what it's rational for Shivani to do in the face of uncertainty. Okay, so how do we calculate the expected value difference according to this theory between two actions? Well, given some background theoretical assumptions, you can write down that expected value difference as basically the sum of two terms. One is the difference that she makes to the next 100 years, and then you can add to that a term that represents the difference she makes to the remaining 1 million years or whatever it is after that. But then each of those two terms in its own term decomposes into two bits. If you want to know what's the expected value difference that Shivani can make to the next 100 years, well, that's given by the temporal length of that interval, namely 100 years, multiplied by the average amount by which she can affect what's going on at a given time across that 100 years. Now, that might be relatively high because you've got a relatively good degree of control over what goes over the next 100 years. On the other hand, the 100 years that you're multiplying it by is only a relatively small number. When you look at the other bit of the calculation, the bit that measures how much good Shivani can do via doing good for the extremely long-run future, you've got one term, the thing I'm writing delta in this formula, which measures what's the average amount by which she can affect what's going on at a given time, averaged across the course of that very long-run future. That's quite a small number. However, what it's being multiplied by is this enormous temporal length of the very long-run future. So the point of decomposing these things in this way is that given that the very long-run future is much, 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 much longer than the short-run, than merely 100 years, unless it turns out to be the case that the average amount by which Shivani can affect what goes on across the very long run future is correspondingly much, 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 much smaller than the average amount by which she can affect the next 100 years. The thing that makes the larger contribution to this sum, and therefore the thing that ultimately determines which of the two actions is better, is going to be the effect that her action has on the very long run future and not the effect that it has on the next 100 years. Okay. So the long-termist wants to conclude from that line of thought that the most cost-effective thing Shivani can do is something that's cost-effective because of how good it is for the very long run. Call that a long-termist intervention. There's a natural objection to this thesis, though, which draws on a hypothesis about the social. Sorry for spelling this. Draws on a hypothesis about the social context in which Shivani is operating. If it was the case that there were already lots of people like Shivani floating around, and all of these people were optimizing in the same way that Shivani is trying to optimize, that is, all of these people were trying to fund the most cost-effective intervention that hadn't yet been funded, where they were evaluating things in completely impartial, completely time-neutral terms, then it probably wouldn't be the case that the most cost-effective things Shivani could do for the very long-run future were more cost-effective than the most cost-effective ways by which she could improve the short-run future. And the reason for that is clear if you think in terms of an analogy with picking fruit from a tree. So here I want to use the metaphor of low-hanging fruit. Suppose that the apples, each of the apples on the left half of this tree represents something Shivani could fund that would improve just the next 100 years, but wouldn't have any effects after that. And suppose that the apples on the right-hand half of the tree represent things Shivani could do aimed at improving the course of the very long-run future, maybe extinction risk mitigation. In this picture, lower-down apples are supposed to represent more cost-effective opportunities. So in the picture, what Shivani is trying to do is pick the lowest apple, whichever side of the tree it happens to be located on. Now, the long-termist thesis says you're going to find much lower apples on the right than you are on the left. The long-termist apples are the low-hanging fruit. But if there were already lots of people like Shivani floating around, and if they were all doing the same optimizing task, then they, if the low-hanging apples originally had been on the right side of the tree, those ones would have already been picked. And at the current margin, what you would expect to see is that all the apples on the left-hand side of the tree have been picked up to some level, and then the unfunded ones are the apples that were higher up from that, less cost-effective. And on the right-hand side of the tree, you would expect that the apples that had already been picked went up to precisely the same level. Because if they hadn't been, then the decision makers who were coming along before would have picked more apples from whichever side of the tree had the lower threshold until the thresholds equalized. Okay, so if there was a sufficiently large army of people like Shivani already out there, all optimizing in completely time-neutral terms, then you'd expect long-termism to be false. You'd expect, on average, that the best short-termist things Shivani could do will be precisely as cost-effective as the best long-termist things she could do. The point, though, is that that's not the way that most current resource allocators are behaving. Shivani is actually quite unusual. The vast majority of resource allocators, whether they be private individuals, large corporations, governments, or whatever, exhibit significant bias towards the short term. This is for various reasons. One thing is just that people are impatient, as a psychological matter of fact. The other thing is that, perhaps quite rationally, they're not completely impartial. They're not perfect moral agents. They have significant preference for their own welfare over the welfare of other people, and since they're located in the present and in the near future, they're going to prefer present and near future welfare over the welfare of these people in the very far future who they've never met. So because most resource allocators at the moment are behaving in that kind of way, in terms of the tree analogy, what they're doing is they're selectively picking fruit from the left, from the short-termist half of the tree. And because they're behaving that way, that actually gives us an additional reason to think that what Shivani should expect to find when she comes down to the tree is that the most cost-effective things are located on the right in terms of the analogy. So the most cost-effective things are the long-termist interventions. They're the things that are aimed at improving the course of the very long-run future. Nobody else cared about doing that thing, so the opportunities have been left there for Shivani to fund. Okay, so tying all that together then, here's what I take to be the core plausibility argument for long-termism. First, we should expect that there were, in the first place, interventions that had sufficiently high long-term delta, that is to say, they were able to affect what goes on average over the course of the very long-run future by, yes, a small amount, but a sufficiently high amount, so that those opportunities were more cost-effective than the best unfunded short-termist interventions. And the reason for expecting that is this stuff about the astronomical size of the long-run future. And then secondly, because most actors at the moment, most resource allocators, are significantly biased towards the short term, we should expect that many of those long-termist interventions are currently unfunded, whereas we don't, to the same extent, expect to fund the same thing in the arena of short-termist interventions. And putting those two things together, the conclusion is we should expect that long-termism is true for Shivani at the current margin, given the way most other people are behaving at the moment. Okay, I'm going to try another pause for questions. Someone be brave. Thank you.
Is that presumed that there are on both sides the same number of apples?
Not necessarily, no. It doesn't matter how many apples there are in total. The question for Shivani is just, is the lowest apple on the tree on the left or on the right? And in particular, do you find lots of low-hanging apples on the right? And then the next lowest one on the left significantly higher than that. There could be, it doesn't matter what's going on higher up, there could be lots of really ineffective things you could do in the short-termist arena and that wouldn't change the argument. Anyone else? Okay. All right then, so the last section then. What about this empirical question? Are there sufficiently tractable opportunities to influence the very long-run future? So all I've said so far was supposed to be a plausibility argument. It was supposed to predispose you towards thinking that, you know, maybe long-termism is a thing we should take seriously. We can see some reasons why it might be true. But I haven't yet proved it's true because I haven't given you any examples of things you could actually do to influence the way things go, even a tiny bit, over the course of the very long-run future. So you might be thinking something like, well, actually, in terms of that toy model, I think that parameter that measures the average amount by which I can affect the very long-run future is basically zero. The toy model said if long-termism is going to be false, then the amount by which you can affect the very long-run future is going to have to be really, really, really small compared to the amount by which you can affect the short-run future. You might think, yeah, and that's just true. So long-termism is false. So that's the thing I want to address next.
Maybe one question after all. So you assume that long-term effects are even well-defined. I mean, that's maybe not a completely trivial assumption, right? For short-term effects, it's pretty clear that we can attribute effects to certain causes, but for what happens long-term, it becomes, just imagine, we think about what happens now, what are its causes in history way back, that seems often relatively arbitrary to make these decisions. Is that potentially an issue for the very meaningfulness of long-termism?
I think not, right? So we are talking about decision-making under uncertainty, but nothing in the story presupposes even that in 1,000 years' time we will then be in a position to know, oh yeah, this thing that happened was a result of
right.
this intervention. We just use our well-informed credences about the matter at the time of decision. Help.
Yeah. Well, there. Yeah. I mean, we are heading the entire philosophy of causality is in some way relevant to the very meaning of those concepts, right? Of those terms.
Yeah, I mean, I think this discussion is pretty robust to that stuff, actually. So you could even think there's not like what philosophers would call counterfactual determinism here, even.
Right.
There's no fact of the matter about precisely what would happen if I did this versus that.
Right.
Maybe the world's indeterministic, you know. So, but even then, that's fine too for the purpose of this discussion, because, you know, if you think there's indeterminism, then, well, you just
right.
consider what's the probability distribution that would follow
right.
from doing this versus that.
Right.
And we were already talking about probability distributions
mm.
because of our ignorance anyway. So I don't think it actually
right.
disposes anything.
Could be that in practice the worry boils down to the one that you're not going to assess.
I think so.
Yeah, could be.
Obviously I do. Okay, so let's talk about tractability. So here's the objection. Again, you might think long-termism is false because what I'll call the washing out hypothesis is true. What do I mean by the washing out hypothesis? So that's the hypothesis that the magnitude of the average effects of your actions on the future tends to decay with time from the point of action. And furthermore, it decays sufficiently fast, so it gets smaller and smaller the further out into the future you go, that is to say. It decays in that sense sufficiently fast that in fact the short-term effects tend to dominate these calculations you do under uncertainty when you're computing the expected value of this versus that action. Now, I think that's very plausible for some decision context, and we could talk about the details, but what I want to argue is that it's not plausible as an account of what's going on in Shivani's decision context. I think if she's choosing carefully, the very best thing she could do will resist the general tendency of things to wash out over time. How could that be? All right, so maybe it's helpful to have, as a clarificatory matter, this thing I skipped over on the previous slide, actually. I said it's plausible that washing out is true for sufficiently trivial decisions. Consider, for example, the decision about whether or not to help somebody across the road on your way home tonight. So you're going home from this lecture, you see someone who's carrying this enormous load of shopping, they're struggling across the road, you have a decision to make. Do you just kind of pretend you didn't see and walk on by, or do you offer to stop and help the person carry their shopping to their house? Now, you might think that's going to be a paradigmatic case of something where the majority of the benefit of what you do is in the short term, not the long term. You make this other person's evening more or less pleasant, but you don't expect anything of long-term significance to follow from that. If we're not talking about uncertainty, though, actually there's a sense in which you're wrong if you think that. And this is a quite interesting result, maybe a surprising result, about the causal structure of our universe. So, you know, here goes an excursion into philosophy. If you glaze over on this next bit, and don't worry about it, I'll get back closer to reality in a minute. Well, but actually, this is about reality. It's just a very abstract set of considerations about reality. I think it's kind of fun and interesting and illuminating when you see it. So, you know, like, here goes, but if you don't get it, don't worry. Okay, so suppose I decide to help this person across the road. What's that going to do besides making them happier? Well, one thing it's going to do is it's going to change the timing, either make it earlier or make it later, by a few seconds, of all the interactions that that person has for the rest of their day, and also it's going to make a timing difference to all the interactions that I have for the rest of my day. So, for example, suppose that if I didn't stop to help the person across the road, I would have gone around the corner and bumped into somebody and said sorry, or I'd have gone around the corner and bumped into an old friend and stopped for a 10-minute conversation. If I do decide to help the person across the road, well, then I'll be a few minutes later, a few seconds later even, proceeding around the corner, and those things that would otherwise have happened will not in fact happen if I stop to help. Now, you can see then how this chain of interactions is going to cascade. If I've made a difference to whether or not I bumped into an old friend, or I've made a difference to whether or not I accidentally tripped someone over, then I'm going to have made a difference to which people they met for the remainder of their day as well, because I've affected the timings of their day. If I stop and delay an old friend for 10 minutes, they're not going to bump into the same people later in that day as they would have done if I hadn't stopped and delayed them for 10 minutes. Where am I going with this? Well, the most obvious route by which this could turn out to lead to effects on the very long run future is that some people conceive a child on a given evening. And if you have this cascade of effects on the precise timing of people's days, if that cascade reaches a couple who are destined to conceive a child on the day in question, then you may not change the question of whether or not they conceive a child. That may go the same way that it would have done anyway. But what you will do is you will change the question of which sperm wins the race. Why do we care about that? Well, you've changed the genetic material of the child that got conceived. Genetics is an important determinant, not the only determinant, but it's an important determinant of the way that child's life ends up going. So if you make a difference to which child gets conceived, you know, it would have been Jack 1 and now it's Jack 2. Jack 1, because he's got different genetic material, goes on to lead a very different life to Jack 2. Maybe he has a different career, maybe he settles in a different city. Your decision about, your apparently trivial decision about whether or not to help the person across the road is now causally, not morally, but causally responsible for all the differences between the things that Jack 1 would have done in his life and the things that Jack 2 would do in his life. Now, consider the question of whether you expect, in aggregate, the differences between all things Jack 1 does and all things Jack 2 does to cancel one another out precisely enough that the difference between the value of Jack 1's life and the value of Jack 2's life is smaller than the amount of happiness that you generated by helping the amount of happiness you directly generated by helping the person across the road. I think that's extremely implausible. Jack 1 and Jack 2 are very different people. In general, some lives are much happier than much others. It's overwhelmingly plausible that the difference in value between Jack 1's life and Jack 2's life is more than the amount of happiness in having your shopping cart across the road for you. So the point of all that is that even in the context as apparently trivial as helping someone across the road or not, if we're not talking about expected value, and we're talking about the way things actually turn out as the dice fall, then the vast majority of the value of your actions lies in the long run future. I find that extremely surprising and quite illuminating once you've thought through the process by which that can happen. However, if you are talking about uncertainty, which we are, and this is why it's an irrelevant excursion, if you glazed over, don't worry, if you are talking about uncertainty, that stuff is actually completely irrelevant. And the reason it's irrelevant is because while it's possible that helping the person across the road could lead to the creation of Jack 1 rather than Jack 2, it's also equally possible and equally plausible that refraining from helping the person across the road could lead to the creation of Jack 1 rather than Jack 2. So these things, when you're doing your expected value calculations, tend to precisely cancel one another out. And that's why, at the end of that long story, in expected value terms, the washing out hypothesis is true for relatively trivial decision contexts, like the decision about whether or not to help somebody across the road. Okay, so that is the bit on that slide. But then I want to argue that Shivani's decisions, at least if she's choosing carefully, if she's not spending her $1 million helping people across roads, but she's instead really trying seriously to do the most cost-effective thing, then washing out is not going to be true of the things that she's doing. And there are basically three categories of things she might do, such that I think we can see clearly how doing this thing might resist the tendency to wash out. One is reducing risks of premature human extinction, and then the second two both fall into the bucket of improving the value of the future, conditional on no premature human extinction. And then there are two kinds of things you can do within that bucket. One is speeding up progress, and one is implementing a so-called trajectory change. So let me say a little bit more about each of those three things. Firstly, extinction risk mitigation. We live in a technologically very dangerous era. Humanity has, in the last 50 years or so, constructed various technologies which in some sense could be forces for good, but also carry significant risks, and currently several of them carry extremely severe risks and could potentially even render humanity extinct. One thing we could do then that you might think has extremely high expected value is basically anything we could think of that would, even by a small amount, reduce the risk of premature human extinction from, for example, climate change or nuclear weapons or artificial intelligence or synthetic biology. Why are those going to be good options in the face of uncertainty? Well, because while Shivani is only going to be able to reduce the chance of premature extinction by an extremely small amount, plausibly the badness of premature human extinction is a really large number. And then if we remember the way expected value calculations work, they multiply the probabilities by the values. So even if you've got a very small probability, if you're multiplying that by a sufficiently large number, you can be doing something that's very good in expected value terms. And this is what a sizable fraction of the effective altruist community thinks. They think that because premature human extinction will be so extremely bad, anything we can do to reduce its probability, even by a tiny amount, is just about the best thing that Shivani could do with her money. That view, however, rests on a controversial position in moral philosophy, and not everybody agrees with that position. The view it basically rests on is called totalism. That's the view that if you want to construct an index of how good a complete history of the universe is, from Big Bang to heat death, roughly what you should do is add up all the well-being, if you like, add up all the happiness that that history contains across the whole duration of time. The controversial feature of that is that it doesn't draw a distinction between increasing the happiness of people who already exist, or people who are going to exist either way, regardless of what you do, on the one hand, and creating extra happiness by bringing extra people into existence who will then be happy, on the other hand. It just adds up all the happiness. So anything you can do to increase the total amount of happiness contained in the universe is just as good as anything else you can do to increase total happiness by the same amount, according to totalism, regardless of whether it's a matter of improving existing lives or creating new lives. But many people think that's just not the right way to think about the value of creating additional lives. If creating additional happy lives is valuable at all, these other people think, at any rate, it's not as valuable as improving the happiness of existing people. So if you disagree with totalism for that kind of reason, then your view about the badness of premature human extinction might be something more like, okay, it's bad, maybe it's even very bad, but it's not so enormously astronomically bad that even reducing its probability by a tiny, tiny, tiny amount still generates enormous expected value. So there are hard questions lurking in the background in moral philosophy here. I have my own views on them, but that's not the topic of this talk. The point for this talk is that extinction risk mitigation is a controversial option. Some people think it's extremely valuable, but not everybody agrees. So for that reason, what I wanted to try and think through is, well, is there a more robust case for long-termism that doesn't rely on prospects for reducing premature human extinction? If we can find ways to improve the average well-being of the people who continue to live, conditional on humanity not going extinct, that's going to be a thing that everybody agrees is valuable, whether they buy this totalism stuff or not. So that's why I'm interested in the second and third buckets, which were improving, so speeding up progress and implementing a so-called trajectory change. Let me say just a little bit about how those go, and then I'll wrap up for the real Q&A session. Okay, so speeding up progress, what do I mean by that? And why might that be valuable for long-termist reasons? Suppose you think that, generally speaking, humanity is on an upward trajectory, for whatever reason. It could be about moral progress, or it could be about economic progress, or whatever. If you think that, generally speaking, things are getting better through time, then if there's anything you can do to speed up that process, kind of shift the curve to the left, as it were, the result that will have is that at any given time in the future, people living at that time will be slightly better off than they would otherwise have been, because they will be slightly higher up the progress curve than those people at that given time in the future would otherwise have been. But now, if you've managed to do something that makes people at every future time, across the course of an extremely long run future, a million years or whatever, makes all those people slightly better off, then when you add up the benefits you've delivered to all those people, because there are so many of them, you could potentially generate an extremely large number. So this is the kind of thing that plays into the hands of the long-termist logic. You can see how the story would go if you're doing this speeding up progress kind of project, about how this could add up to an enormous amount of value, and something that would compete very favorably with the best things we could do to improve just the short term. Okay, so that was the speeding up progress bucket, and then there was also this other bucket that I was calling trajectory changes. So this is not a matter of just bringing things forward in time. Trajectory changes are more attempts to influence which trajectory the future of the universe goes on. Not make it just do the same thing but faster, or the same thing but earlier, but change the very path that it takes. Some attempts to do that might resist washing out. They'll resist washing out if there exist suitable examples of what physicists call attractor states. So these are states of the universe such that if the universe once wanders into one of these states, it tends to stay there for a very long time. So if you've got two or more possible futures of the universe, and if you think that whichever one we end up in, we're likely to stay there, there's going to be some mechanism that keeps us there for a very long time, and if one of them's good and the other one's bad, then anything you can do now to slightly increase the probability that you end up in the good one rather than a bad one. If you're now in this kind of privileged or hingy position where things could go either way, you're not yet in either of the states, and you can do something to influence which one you end up getting stuck in, then that could have very long-run influence because of the stickiness that's built into the definition of these attractor states. Once you get there, you tend to stay there, so things won't wash out. Okay, so then the empirical question is, well, are there actually any opportunities that are like that? But it's plausible to think that there are. Here are some examples. You might think that certain kinds of political arrangements have this feature. Things like the constitution for a democracy is an item that tends to last for an extremely long time. So if you think that sometime in the relatively near future, not necessarily in your lifetime, because you can pass on money after you die, but sometime in, say, the next few centuries, there's going to be written a new constitution that will then subsequently be extremely influential over the question of how the world is run, maybe it's even a world constitution, then something like saving up money to fund the lobbyists that would influence the content of that constitution in a direction that's more rather than less conducive to human well-being could constitute an opportunity to have significant long-term expected value, because constitutions are very sticky things. Once they're in place, they're very hard to change, and even when you do change them, the very process that governs how they get changed is itself governed by the content of the first constitution. So you can have influence that passes on down the various versions of this constitution. That's just one example. A second example would be artificial general intelligence. Researchers in machine learning now assign quite significant credence to the possibility that within our lifetimes, or not far beyond, there could be created artificially intelligent agents that are more intelligent than humans. If so, these agents are likely to exhibit very significant influence over how the world is run. And we could do things now that influence what values get built into these agents, whether they have something like human values and they're basically trying to influence the world in ways that are conducive to human welfare, or whether they've got some completely other goal in mind, if you don't mind the metaphorical language, and they therefore eat up resources pursuing this other goal that's not conducive to human welfare and takes resources away from the thing that we want to try and do. So since we don't yet have an artificially intelligent, super intelligent agent, there are things we can now do while we're still in the development phase to influence the way that that process goes, try to get it to the case, to be the case that the superintelligent agent, if one is ever created, embodies well-being conducive values rather than well-being anti-conducive values. And then if you've got that kind of structure, it's also plausible that you've got this feature in place that there's the stickiness, there's the attractor state feature. Because once you have an artificially intelligent agent, it's not going to be mortal like you and me. Once it's around, it's likely to be around for a very long time. A more prosaic example would come from climate change. If what's bad about extreme climate change is that the more extreme climates or the more heated up climates are just permanently less conducive to human well-being than the less extreme climate changes, then things we can do now to mitigate climate change, reduce the risk that we get the extreme rather than the more moderate version, would be standard examples of routes to very long-run influence. If you're not convinced by any of those examples, but you nonetheless think that there's maybe something to some of these lines of thought, then you might be interested in a meta option that's also available to Shivani. One thing she could do with some of her money is throw lots of money at the project of trying to figure out the answer to this question. If she could, say, spend the first half of her money on figuring out what's the best way to beneficially influence the course of the very long-run future, and then spend the second half of her money on doing whatever intervention then looks best in the light of the information that's delivered by the research that she's funded with the first half of her money, then that compound action itself could have extremely high expected value relative to the information and the probabilities that we have now. So I actually think this is a very plausible contender for the best thing Shivani could do. Okay, so in summary then, I've tried to suggest that long-termism is prima facie very plausible. I think the main open question is this empirical question, not actually a philosophical one, of whether the project of affecting this expected course of the very long-run future is sufficiently tractable, or whether we just don't have enough causal handle on the future to have any control over the way things go in the very long run. If you assume this controversial feature of moral theory that I call totalism, then I think the answer is pretty clearly positive. You can do back-of-the-envelope calculations for how valuable extinction risk mitigation then counts as being, and it's going to be very hard for anything short-termist to compete with the expected value numbers that you then get. But I also, more ambitiously, tried to sketch some reasons for thinking that the long-termist project is tractable enough to make the best things Shivani could try to do long-termist things, even if you don't accept this totalist moral philosophy. I tried to sketch some first-order options to do with speeding up progress and implementing trajectory changes, and then I tried to convince you that even if you don't really like my suggestions, if you think there's anything in them at all, if you think they're worthy of further thought, then it might nonetheless be that a high-value thing Shivani could do now is fund some research and then save some money to do whatever then seems best in light of the research. Thanks.
Thank you very much. We now have quite some time still for Q&A. So maybe I can start with the questions for you. So you talked about what Shivani should maybe do, but I think few people here have $1 million or even $5 billion. I think there's maybe fewer people. So what should people do with their personal resources, with their personal time, if they would buy into the long-termism thesis?
Okay, so you said two things there which I think are actually quite different questions, personal resources and personal time. So as far as money is concerned, I made Shivani rich just to make the case study more concrete, but it doesn't make any difference actually what number you plug in for how much money Shivani has. If she has $1 or $1 billion, she still faces the same decision problem. We're still looking for the highest amount of good she can do per dollar donated, and the arguments are not going to change. So whatever amount of money you have, if you've, say, signed up to effective altruism and you've decided you want to give away 10% of your salary, however large or small that is, the same sets of considerations are going to be relevant to you. And one way of seeing how this is plausible is to note that the effective altruism community in the last few years has set up these funds, which some of you probably know about. Once you've decided which you think is the most cost-effective cause area, you can tell the effective, the people who run the effective altruist funds, which of their funds you want to donate to. There's a global health and poverty fund, there's an animal welfare fund, there's a far future fund, and there's also a build the effective altruism community fund. That's another kind of meta option. If you're convinced of long-termism, then you can donate your 10% of your salary to the far future fund, and it doesn't matter how big or small that salary is. The considerations are going to be the same either way. Okay, you also asked about time. That, as I'm sure you know, is a much more complicated question. That's not going to be the same for all people, because what you should do with your time, insofar as your aim is to do the most good, is going to depend very sensitively on what your skill set is. So there's no one-size-fits-all answer, and we need to go into the details of what kind of person are we talking about here, what are they good at. But for example, you might choose to go into politics rather than development economics if you were convinced of long-termism.
And for people who want to know more about what to do with your time, you can look on 80,000 hours. I can give you a link later if you're interested in that. Now, some other questions.
I completely agree with your conclusion that the main open question is whether affecting the expected value of the long-term future is sufficiently tractable. Do you think this main open question itself is tractable? Can progress be made on this question, or will it always be speculation about potential trajectories by which we can affect the long-term future?
I want to challenge a presupposition of your question, if I may. Yes, I think progress can be made on the question, but yes, I also think it's probably always going to be speculation. However, that comes back to the thing I said right at the beginning. Right? I mean, if you're schooled in the maybe old-school effective altruist mode of thinking, you're kind of anti-speculation, you want your randomized controlled trial. I'm sorry, but they just can't take on all questions, but speculation isn't that bad.
No, okay. But you think progress within speculation can be made?
I do indeed, and I tried to take some baby steps towards that tonight.
Good.
Yeah, just one thing that kept coming back. The aim is to do good. And it is not defined, then there's sort of self-evident what's good for us. But if you go into long-termism, is how would you interpret good? Would it sort of be an option that what we consider good would not be considered good anymore in, say, a number of years? Say our good and evil are specified or are influenced by being Homo sapiens, it might be that in the end the organisms living there will have very different interpretations of what's good rather than bad. And is your sort of argument vulnerable to this issue, or do you consider it a non-issue, or could you react to this?
Yeah, it's not a non-issue, definitely. I think there are two key things there. So one is so you're right, I used the word good a lot, and I didn't say what kind of thing I was taking to count as better or worse.
Mm-hmm.
The hope is that actually the conclusions of this line of reasoning are relatively robust to normal and plausible variations among in the arena of current disagreements that say moral philosophers have one another about precisely which states of affairs should overall be counted as better than which others. There are always going to be various desiderata that you sometimes have to trade off against one another, and some people will weight things differently than others. But I think it is true, I didn't go into this in the talk, I think it is true that for the kinds of disagreements we have at the moment, those disagreements make relatively little difference to the question of whether long-termism is plausible, basically for the reason that everybody agrees that happiness and welfare more generally are good things, and all I was talking about were things that would broadly speaking improve human welfare. There aren't really people going around saying, well, actually, I think that's a bad thing, so anti-long-termism. The other interesting question you raised, though, was the question of value change. So what do we think might be true of the values of humans, or more generally, agents in the future?
Mm-hmm.
How confident are we that their values are going to be similar than our own? I think that's a very important question. And we can see that it's non-trivial by thinking, of course, about how much values have changed over, say, the last 2,000 years. It's not completely unrecognizable, but there are some significant shifts. I think we do need to think about that question, but the fact that its answer is non-obvious doesn't simply undermine the long-termist project. Rather, what it does is it plays into relatively detail-level questions like how seriously should we take the option of just saving up lots of resources and deferring to future people to decide what to do with them. That's going to be a good idea if we think either that they're basically going to share our values but have more information, or if we believe in a notion of moral progress and we think, well, they'll just have better values than us, then deferring the decision to them looks like a really good idea. If, on the other hand, we think this kind of random drift all over the place, we like our values, those are the things we want to promote, but we have no particular reason for thinking that future people share them, then we're going to want to more directly do actions that influence the way the world goes, rather than doing things that empower future people to influence it in the way that they want.
Do you feel like your questions have been answered?
Yeah, I think there's a lot.
Discuss, maybe not answer, discuss.
Yeah, this is good.
Any other questions? Yes.
I wrote it down. Constant beneficial near time, cost effective rational decision making make up for what constant long term cost effective rational decision making results would do if only one or the other were to exist? And if both were to exist, can we say that constant long term rational cost effective decision making's results are significantly different in nature or value than the near term results? And if so, then we could say that both are necessary.
Well, I'm not sure I completely understand the question. By the short-termist decision-making, are you thinking the things that you would do if you only cared about, say, the next 100 years and just didn't care about what happened beyond that? And the long-term decision-making is what you would do if you're optimizing for the remainder? And then the question is, do those two things generate the same results? Well, that's part of the question, is that right?
Yes, because we think that we only have a constant present, then if we were to have a constant beneficial near-time cost-effective rational decision-making in the present, which would have immediate results in the present, then we would have a constant progress that takes place in the present. And that would mean that in the long term, we would have the constant present and we could see the benefits. So that would mean, the question is, could a constant present make up for what a constant long-term cost-effective rational decision-making results would do if only one or the other were to exist?
Okay, so if I understand the question correctly, is what I think of as being the question of alignment between what the short-termist lens recommends and what the long-termist lens recommends. Some people have conjectured that you don't really need to work out whether it's the short-term effects or the long-term effects that dominate the decision, that dominate the expected value calculation, because whichever one it is, they're going to point in the same direction, they're going to recommend the same actions. A phrase I find useful here is suspicious convergence. So it would be extremely surprising, ex ante, if there were that kind of precise alignment between what's recommended by one recipe and what's recommended by another recipe, when the things those two recipes are trying to optimise for are so extremely different. So you might well think, I think it's very reasonable to think that there are things that look very good, both by short-termist lights and by long-termist lights. And here you might be thinking of things like global peace and security, education, things like that. Those are good for short-termist reasons, they benefit people's lives now, but they also globally increase the chance that the long-run future goes in the best way. When you're really doing the hard-nosed optimizing thing, though, and you're not just asking, okay, find me something that's good both for the short-term and for the long-term, but you're asking, find me the thing that's very best for the short-term and then find me the thing that's very best for the long-term, I think it's much less plausible that those two questions will generate the same answer.
Simon, you had a question.
So in economics, I have recently learned that discounting is a big thing, right? If you invest, for instance, in real estate and expect to get a monthly rent or so, you want this to pay off in a couple of years or maybe decades, and that means for things that happen 30 years down the road, if you get the rent that you get, then you don't value it very highly right now, right? So. I think, I don't know the full motivation for discounting, but I think it has also to do with uncertainty about the future. So why are you confident that the discount rate should be zero or very low in this very general case, when in typical economical considerations, I think it's actually surprisingly high often in realistic context, something like 7% or so, which would amount to a version of short-termism, right?
So, that's right. Yeah, I mean, it depends. There's lots of different components of the discount rate, and it depends
right.
which ones we're talking about. But as for the uncertainty component,
yeah.
like one thing you mentioned, yeah, it's true. If you become less and less confident that your intervention will have the desired consequence the further you go into the future, then that generates a declining schedule of discount
right.
factors that tends to suppress the importance of the long-term stuff. But this is just the washing out concern, right? So my reply to that was, yeah, that might happen for lots of actions, but if we're specifically going around looking for actions of which that doesn't happen, then we can find some.
Mm.
The more abstract point being, there's not just one discount rate for uncertainty that applies equally to all projects, because different projects generate different kinds of uncertainty. And my conjecture was, for example, that if you manage to find these attractor state structures, those are going to be ones where you don't get like long-term dampening from uncertainty.
So that answer your question?
Yeah, thanks.
Andy, you had a question?
Yes, I just a little bit back to what's your name, sorry, to what you just asked there. I was wondering if you take a long-term perspective, but you think there's something like, I don't know, economics, sort of how he calls it, local knowledge or something, you might think there's something like temporal knowledge, and so you might be thinking we're pretty good at sorting out what we know now, and future people will be pretty good at knowing sort of what's going to happen there and better at taking decisions then maybe there might be a way of course you can't you still to take a long-term perspective, but maybe that you try to prevent kind of the attractor state to some extent, or lock-ins, or any kind of path dependencies that constrain future generations from being able to determine their own lot to some extent, right?
Right.
So at first you can constrain the choice there to some extent in this sort of conservative way that leaves kind of option and freedom of the future open. And that will then allow you then still to choose among those more closely than with short-term perspectives. And so you just structure the choice sets in a way that leaves it open for future generations. And then the second argument for that would also be that you might think with growing, like more economic growth, maybe better research, more university, maybe even AI might be help us be smart and so on, that the future will be better, future people will be better to determine some of those intractable problems.
Right.
So the best is we can do prevent lock-ins. And then once we've done that, to some extent, and capacity building, but once we've done that, we can also do some short-termism.
Yeah. Oh, so the last word surprised me.
Well, no, maybe I should have said that, not do short-termism, but to be slightly less worried about kind of intractable problems that arise from giving some priority. I think when you have like differences in the short term, like you already kind of ruled out that these are like, not ruled out, maybe less like these are options that have like huge long term effects, and you're okay doing that sometimes.
Yeah, I take this, what I was going to say before you said short term is at the end of your
question.
I'm
a little confused.
I was going to say this sounds like a suggestion for prioritization amongst different long termist interventions. So, long termism is true. Now the question is, what at the finer grain level of detail follows from that? And I was interpreting your suggestions as being very sensible, plausible suggestions for an answer to that question, but not as a challenge to long-termism.
No, at all.
I mean, there's an open question of how different the recommendations that would follow from that way of thinking would be from the kind of things long-termists would anyway be thinking about. So, for example, if you thought that extinction was bad, then it still seems, in the light of these considerations, that basically you should be throwing all of your philanthropic dollars at extinction risk mitigation, right? Because you said, all we have to do is avoid lock-in, and then we can defer to future people. But, extinction is a pretty good example of a lock-in scenario, so we should still be throwing everything at avoiding that. That is, merely avoiding lock-in is not a small project.
No, absolutely, yeah. But I was wondering, throwing everything at extinction risk, I wonder if there's sort of at some point increasing marginal utility.
Oh, yeah, for sure. Yeah, it doesn't matter how much money you've got.
There are other kind of lock-ins you can avoid, and other kind of maybe capacity building, like research and preventing off other people doing bad lock-ins and so on.
Right. I mean, eventually you would hit diminishing marginal returns, but I don't think we're in much danger of hitting
sufficiently
fast diminishing ones anytime soon, unfortunately.
Yeah, yeah.
So maybe one or two more questions? Yes?
Yes. You mentioned before that we're pretty bad at thinking about these long-term things as a society, and I'm wondering, are there maybe some short-term goals that we can outline that would get society to be more effective in thinking and influencing the long-term future? So for example, if you're poor and you have a lot of considerations that pose existential risk to you on a daily basis, that means it's much harder for you to think in abstract terms because you have so many things to consider right at this moment. So I'm wondering, are there policies, especially because you're also in the Global Priorities Institute, actually, or the president, if I remember correctly from the beginning, are there also some short-term things that you focus on that will get us to more effectively, as a society, focus on long-term things? Because it's one thing to point out these things ethically have the highest consideration, and then thinking, how can we get there, and maybe there are some intermediary goals that we need to achieve first.
That's right, yeah. I mean, so this is an important question, that, you know, what are the most appropriate short-term proxy goals that we have sufficiently good, yes, speculative, but sufficiently good speculative reason for thinking are likely to be reliably correlated with the long-term thing that we ultimately care about. I mean, I could throw out some suggestions, but I don't consider myself an expert on this. The obvious things to consider, besides just society taking extinction risk a lot more seriously than it currently does, things that are, in particular things that are important because related to that, are things like global cooperation, reducing the chance of major war between the great powers, that kind of thing.
And maybe more specifically on something like universal basic income, which would reduce a lot of the stress on people individually that make them more prone to abstract thinking?
It would, yeah. I think it would depend on... I think that the strongest case for universal basic income is more a short-termist one, just directly looking at the welfare of the people who receive the income. It's true that there would be these collateral benefits, that they become more able to pay attention to things significantly beyond themselves. However, the kind of callous brute fact of the matter is the people who will be significantly impacted by the universal basic income are often not people who are exerting significant influence over the long-run trajectory of humanity. So you might want to more pay attention to how is the President of the United States behaving. I mean, these are all hard questions. Like I said, I don't consider myself an expert.
All right, I see one last... Oh, I see four questions. I kind of saw the person in the back is first, so you can have the last question.
I feel like long-termism is kind of dissing the present, and short-termism, right? Short-termism could be used as a meme to long-termism. It's hard to say. Long-termism, and I think we shouldn't see them as opposite, but more as complementary, and one can help the other be effectively realized. And that's not what I quite get from what you're saying.
Could you post that as a question?
No, it's fine.
Okay. Yeah.
I disagree. So I think this is basically the question of alignment that we were discussing earlier. Right? I mean, they would be complementary perspectives if they recommended the same things in practice. But I just don't think that's plausible. So the kind of things that Givewell initially exclusively recommended were optimize for short-term impact. You know, let's focus on the fact that some people in the world are vastly less well-off than ourselves, and because money has diminishing marginal returns to well-being, we can do much more good by channeling money towards those people. That looks extremely good by short-termist lights. It's much less clear, though, what the long-run implications of doing that are, whereas if you're really trying to optimize for the long term and you want to resist washing out in expectation, you're really looking for something where there's a positive reason to expect something like this attractor state dynamics to be going on. And we just don't see that, or at least the case for thinking it's there is extremely sketchy in the case of interventions that you would naturally select when you were just optimizing for the short term. So because I don't believe that kind of alignment hypothesis, yes, I agree with this other questioner that for practical purposes, we crucially need to identify suitable short-term proxies for our long-term goals, but I don't think it's plausible that the things that are the best short-term proxies for the long-term goals are also the things that you would pick if you were just trying to optimize for the short-term in the first place.
Education, for example. If you educate the new generation, then for the generations after, it would still have an impact, which would be a short-term action that would lead to greater good in the long term.
I think this kind of alignment suggestion is worthy of more discussion, but I mean, maybe we can agree it's like it's not obviously true that education is the very best thing by long-termist lights. It's also not obviously true it's the very best thing by short-termist lights. So yeah, you can make alignment conjectures. I'm personally very sceptical about precise alignment turning out to be true. And you go to kind of on statistical reasoning, you should be sceptical about this, right? You've got these two very independently defined things. It would be an astonishing coincidence if they just happened to hit on the same thing.
Yeah, I kind of agree.
So if you want to continue this discussion, we will have a half an hour or so for drinks. So then we can run it off now, and people who want to go home can go home, and then we can continue with some drinks. So thank you very much, Professor Graves, for this wonderful talk. So let's give another applause.